SANDHAN, All Gujarat Integrated Classroom.
Satellite ના માધ્યમથી જોડતી કડી એટલે સંધાન.
Good afternoon, dear students. Today we are going to discuss in detail about the most relevant topic, which is not only applicable in theory but is to be used for the practicals too. You will have to be using the culture media for cultivating the organisms. As we will see later that what are the utilities of the culture media, but to just to begin, whenever you are studying a microbiology, you will need culture media to grow the organisms. In order to study them, we need the material, and for us the material is the microbes, and for growing the microbes we need a culture media. So today we are going to discuss about culture media. With me I have Kiran S. Trivedi.
Hello.
From R.G. Shah Science College, myself Dr. Rakesh Patel from R.G. Shah Science College. We all welcome our students, and we hope to have a very healthy discussions regarding the topic of culture media, principles, types and utility. Now basically, before we begin the discussion of the topic, I would like to state that every living cell requires some nutrients. These nutrients are needed for the sustenance of the individuals. Similarly, microorganisms also needs nutrients. These nutrients are provided by culture media in a artificial laboratory environment. When we use the name culture media, it is always to be assumed that we are discussing about the cultivating the organisms artificially in laboratory. Now the details of the nutrients, what are the basics of the media, and how the history of this nutrient media dates back to how many years back, who are the prominent personalities, these things will be discussed in detail by Madam Kiran Trivedi.
Thank you, sir. Now as sir has briefly outlined the topic we are going to discuss today, I would definitely like to tell you something, that as we human being, we sustain or we live our life because we get food. Just imagine if we don't get any food, what is going to happen to us? It is very difficult for us to survive. Similarly, in case of microorganism, they also require some kind of food. And this food for microorganism is called as nutrient. So let us first try to find it out, what is nutrient. Nutrients are actually some elements or compounds which are needed by the microbial cell for their growth and replication. So this kind of chemical or elements are termed as nutrient. Now when they get a nutrient, see, this is the picture you will see on the screen, that there is a bacterial cell and the nutrient is going inside the cell. What happens once the cell gets the nutrient? This nutrient is metabolized. After metabolism, some energy is released, and this energy is then utilized for the biosynthesis of different kinds of cellular components. So this is how we can see that the nutrients are very important for the growth and reproduction of microorganism. Whenever we talk about the nutrient, as you will understand from the picture, that why the nutrients are given so much of importance, because from the nutrient the microorganism, they perform various metabolic activities. From these metabolic activities they acquire some energy. Energy will be then used up to build up different cellular components, and as a result of that they can grow and replicate. So ultimately we can understand that the nutrients are very essential for the life of, for the growth of microorganisms. Now nutritional As you understand that we all live in the environment where different kinds of microorganisms are present, and each of this microorganism has the requirement, very specific requirement for nutrient. So how to understand that which organism require what type of nutrient? So to understand the nutritional requirement of microorganism, it is always necessary that we should understand the chemical composition of the microbial cell. You can look at the chart. In this chart, you will find that there are some, we have named some of the elements, like I think on the screen probably it is not very clear. Carbon chart again. This is the chart. Just try to have a glance on this chart. You will find that the some elements are considered to be as a major element, as for example the carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen, phosphorus. But apart from all so many different elements, you will find that the carbon is the one which is acquiring a 50% of the dry weight of the cell. That means the major component of any microbial cell is a carbon. Then similarly the oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen, phosphorus and so on. So from this chart you will understand that some elements are major elements which are very essential for the composition of microbial components. So they are called as macronutrients. Macronutrients means these are the nutrients which are required in larger quantities, in more amounts, and to remember their name, it is very easy. Just you pronounce C. Hopkins coffee mug. C stands for carbon, H stands for hydrogen, O for oxygen, P for phosphorus, and N for nitrogen, S for sulfur, and so on. Similarly, by this simple sentence like C. Hopkins coffee mug, you will remember the macronutrients, name of macronutrients. These macronutrients are playing a very important role in metabolism and growth. As we have seen about the macronutrients, there are micronutrients. What do you mean by this micronutrients? Actually, micronutrients are required in very less quantity. That is, these are the trace elements and they are necessary for the enzymatic functions and for the structure of protein. As for example, if you have a glance at this chart, you will find cobalt, nickel, zinc, magnesium, and these are the different kinds of micronutrients which are required for the enzymatic activity of different kinds of cell. Okay, now once we have talked about the nutrient, now comes the medium. Before medium, I would like to tell you that when we talk about the medium, many more time we use the word culture medium. Culture medium means it is made up of two words, culture and medium. So first let us try to find it out, what is a culture? Culture means in the laboratory when we grow the organism in an artificial media. On artificial media, we get the growth of this microorganism. So whenever we cultivate the microorganism on some medium, we call that growth as a culture. Now comes the medium. What is medium? Medium, it is an artificial environment and it is prepared in the laboratory, and basically it consists of balanced mixture of different kinds of nutrients which are needed by microorganism so as to achieve the optimum growth. Then we will talk about the purpose of culture media. Why do we require the culture media? It is very simple, because to study the properties of microorganism, media are always needed. Next, whenever you want to isolate the wanted or desired type of microorganism, especially from the clinical specimen like the blood or the sputum, then it is very important that we should isolate the organism in pure form. And this is only possible when we make the use of culture media. Similarly, we can perform the antibiotic sensitivity test. This is again important, because to direct the lines of treatment, whenever a patient is suffering from some disease or some infection, we always perform the antibiotic sensitivity. From that we come to know whether the infectious microorganism is sensitive to this particular antibiotic or not. And that antibiotic, if organism is sensitive, we give that antibiotic as a treatment for the disease. And lastly, it is very important to get the commercial fermentative products by using the culture medium. Classification, before we take the history of culture media, we have to take the classification of microorganism, which is based upon the nutritional requirement of a cell. So as I have told you in the very beginning, that how to decide the nutritional requirement of a cell. So actually the nutritional requirement of a cell is basically dependent upon the chemical composition of microbial cell. And on the basis of their nutritional requirement, the microorganism can be classified into different classes. As for example, we can have the organism photolithotrophic. Photolithotrophic means those microorganisms who require the light as a source of energy, and they are using the inorganic compound as an electron donor. Secondly, we have the photoorganotrophic organisms. These organisms, they again require the light as a source of energy, but the electron donor is organic one. Organic compounds are used as electron donor. Chemolithotrophic, they uses the chemical compound as a source of energy, and they uses inorganic compound as electron donor. Then chemoorganotrophic, these organisms again require the chemical compound as a source of energy, but they require the organic compounds as electron donor. Now we come to the history of culture media. On the screen you can see two scientists, and one is Louis Pasteur, second picture is of Robert Koch. I hope all of you are very well aware of these two, the contribution of these two scientists, because all of you are familiar with these two names, but you will also learn that initially these two people, they worked too much to find out the types of media which can be suitable for the growth of microorganism. In this, the Louis Pasteur was the first one who used some liquid medium like urine or meat extract for cultivation of microorganism. Then the Robert Koch made a very good contribution when he realized that some solid media like potato pieces can be used for growing the bacteria. Fanny Hess, the wife of Walter Hess, who has been an assistant to Robert Koch, they used agar as a solidifying media. These are the two beautiful pictures. In the first picture, you can see a petri dish containing the powder of agar. And second, you can see the jelly which we normally use for making different types of desserts. So by using the agar as a solidifying agents, we can always prepare this delicious dishes also. Now coming to the important ingredient, agar-agar basically is a polysaccharide, and it is made up of two important components like agarose and agaropectin. 70% is agarose and 30% is agaropectin. Along with this agarose and agaropectin, they also contain some inorganic salts and protein-like substances. The agar is obtained from seaweed's gelidium. And in the preparation of the medium, we always, whenever we want to prepare the solid medium, we make the use of agar in the concentration of 2 to 3%. And one of the very important property of agar is that it melts at 98 degrees centigrade and can be solid at 42 degrees centigrade. Now, the further discussion will be done by Rakesh sir.
Thank you, Kiran. So, dear friends, now you know the basics of nutrient medium, in a sense that if we want to study or if we want to prepare a medium, we should know about the chemical composition of the cells. And as the definition of the medium goes, It's a balanced formulation. Be careful, the word balanced formulation. Formulation means we are preparing it in a laboratory, in an artificial manner. We are mixing various ingredients, taking little bit of X, little bit of Y in a fixed proportion and mixing them so as to prepare a complete medium which will provide all necessary nutrients to the organisms. Now, balanced means the element which is required in a larger quantity by a cell, that is the carbon, let us say for example, as madam had already discussed earlier, carbon is required in as high as 50% of the cell weight, dry weight of the cell. Naturally, in the medium, carbon should be the main source, followed by nitrogen. It is something like, say for example, when we sit for our lunch or dinner, we would not take more amount of salt as compared to rotis, as compared to dal, rice and all this, because dal, rice and roti, chapatis, that is going to provide us the carbon and nitrogen, and that is why we take it more. While the salt, NaCl, it is just added because NaCl is also necessary, sodium is also a very much essential element. Apart from that, other micro elements, they are not added externally into our diet. They are already present in some green vegetables. However, they are present in a very minor quantity because they are required in a minor amount by the cells, that is for a human body. Same story goes for microorganisms. That is, those nutrients which are required in larger quantity are provided in larger numbers, larger quantity in a medium. While those elements which are required in a smaller amount, naturally their quantity will be smaller. So this is what we call it as a balanced formulation. And in certain cases, the list of formulation is very large. There are about, for example, 15-20 different ingredients which needs to be added specifically when the medium is artificial, that is the synthetic one. So this formulation of a medium has taken a long time to develop, because by trial and error method, that is, the organisms have been, or the medium have been standardized particular organisms. But for a graduation level student, it is enough for him to know that what are the basic requirements of a routine organism which are to be cultivated in the laboratory for his graduation studies. So for example, E. coli or a bacilli or a cocci, these normal organisms, normal means those which are routinely studied in the beginning, these organisms, they require certain basic components. For example, medium should contain water, should have a source of carbon and energy, have a good source of nitrogen, and certain trace elements or growth factors. Apart from this, these medium, when it is prepared in a water, that is the universal solvent, the pH of the medium is a vital one, it is a very important one, and must be accordingly adjusted depending upon the requirement of the organisms. Normally, bacteria which are routinely cultivated, they require slightly alkaline pH, that is, the pH ranges from around 7.4 to 7.6. now, what are these common ingredients, what they will supply? For example, peptone or hydrolyzates of proteins, that is the casein, for example, they are the good source of nitrogen. No doubt, they also are the source of carbon. So peptones or hydrolyzates of proteins, they are providing us the carbon or nitrogen source. Peptones are basically the hydrolyzed products of proteins. And why it is necessary to hydrolyze them? Because peptone, when it is hydrolyzed, it will contain small peptides. Proteins, they are very large molecule. cells are not able to take in those proteins because their molecular weight is very high, their size is very large. Therefore, it is needed to hydrolyze them either enzymatically or by some other methods, so that it is broken down to pieces, that is the peptides. Sometimes it may also contain certain amino acids. Therefore, that is the considered to be a very good source of carbon and nitrogen. Then we have meat extract, yeast extracts, malt extracts, etc., which are the sources of vitamins and growth factors. These are provided in a little amount. However, they are the excellent source of these growth factors. Growth factors are required in a small quantity, but yet they are very essential. Also is the requirement of NaCl, which maintains the osmotic balance. Normally, the osmotic balance of a cell, routine normal cell, is around 0.5%, but in a medium, 0.85%. For a cell, it is 0.85%, but for a medium, we adjust it to 0.5% NaCl, so that it is slightly less. As a result, what will happen? There will be a gradient established, as a result of which water will flow from medium into the cell and will take along with it various dissolved compounds, mainly from peptones or meat extract. So the cell does not have to expend the energy, and down the concentration gradient, the nutrients can easily reach the cell. Well, these are certain ingredients which are required for preparation of a medium. This media, naturally, all these ingredients, they have been dissolved in water, and therefore the medium which is prepared is a liquid medium. But if we want to make the medium solid, what are the reasons and why we need to make it solid, that we'll discuss later on. Then what is needed is a solidifying agent. The solidifying agents can be many. For example, agar agar powder, or even a gelatin, or silica gel, or even in certain cases serum, and certain compounds like materials like eggs. However, most commonly used solidifying agent is agar powder. Advantages are many that we have already been discussed. Now, as you can see in the next figure, you can see various colorful bottles, colorful plates having different types of media. Some of them, they are liquid in consistency, while others are solid. Plates, they always show a solid media, while the bottles and the tubes, they usually have the liquid components, that is the liquid media. On the right hand side of the figure, you can see two plates, that is nutrient agar. One is a slightly yellowish in tinge, having a more amount of peptone, while the lower one has a little bit less peptone, and that is why the difference is there in the color. In the lower plate, you all can also see certain colonies, the growth of the organisms, and in the fourth quadrant, you can see certain isolated colonies too. Now, when we have learned about the basics of the media, let us come to the various types of media, that is the classification of the media. Now, this classification can be done on three categories. One is classification based on consistency, next on basis of nutrient component present in the medium, and third one on the basis of its functional use. The first one, let us see, the classification which is based on the consistency, that is, it has been discussed earlier that the medium can either be a liquid or it can be a solid. Liquid media are referred to as a broth, and they are for use in test tubes, bottles or flasks. While solid media containing the solidifying agents, they are to be used whenever we want to isolate the organisms in a pure form, because organisms on a solid media can form a colony, while on a liquid media the growth is suspended. So one is a liquid media, another one is solid media, third one is semi-solid, that is the consistency is neither liquid nor extremely solid, because it contains less agar, about almost half or even less than that, ranging from 0.2 to 0.5%, and the medium becomes semi-solid. The use of such kind of media is as a top agar or a soft agar, or even in certain biochemical tests like Hughes and Lifson's medium. Now the fourth one, biphasic medium, it's both liquid and solid medium. Such kind of media are usually present, or they are usually used in a Raoult's bottle, where the bottle on one side is flat, and on the flat side we have a solid media which is overlayered with the liquid materials. So when the bottle is in a standing position, the liquid material is at the bottom, while on the sides of the bottle we have agar powder, that is agar medium. Such kind of media are used when we want to transfer the little amount of growth to another one, so that the liquid can easily be transferred without taking the help of any wire loop or pipette directly from one bottle to another. That is, it can be used as an inoculum. Now these are the photographs of various liquid, that is the broth media. On the top there are two, one is in the flask, another is in the tube. Both are the liquid media, that is the broth, while at the bottom one is the solid media, that is in a plate, while another one is there in a corks screw bottle. It is a semi-solid medium. This liquid broth medium, as I have already discussed, does not contain agar, and here the drawback of the medium is that properties of the bacteria are not visible in liquid medium. Properties mean, what I mean to say here is that the colony characteristics of media are not clearly or distinctly observed as we observe it in case of a solid media, and therefore there are certain limitations that we cannot identify the organisms on the basis of its growth, because identification of the organism is one of the key factor. Identification on the basis of the growth is one of the key factor for accurate identification further while selecting the biochemical media and so on. Therefore, in a broth medium, the growth will be always either as a surface pellicle, or either as a uniform turbidity, or even as a sediment, that is at the bottom of the tubes. While in the solid media, as you can see in the figure, you can see a technician pouring a medium in a plate. There are no burners because he is working in a laminar airflow system, which is providing the sterile environment needed for the pouring of the media. Now, what are the advantages of these solid media? Advantages is, you organisms grow as isolated colonies, that is the different colonies of a different organisms can be seen, different colony characters can be studied, and therefore it aids in identification as well as it aids to isolate the organisms in a pure form, because one can easily pick up a well isolated colony and inoculate it into a fresh media. This is how the identification helps. Now the next classification is on the basis of nutritional components present in the medium. On the basis of this, the media can be classified either as a simple and complex, or it can also be classified as a synthetic and natural. Now the first one, what is simple media? The media which we just saw, or which we just studied, where we are using peptone, meat extract, nutrient components, which are very routinely used for cultivation of a routine media, these are non-fastidious bacteria, means they bacteria are so sober that they do not require any extra nutrients. They will do with whatever the peptone has, whatever the meat extract has, and the, all their growth requirement is met with them. These kinds of media are known as a simple media, or they are the one which are used for growing non-fastidious media. Nutrient media are one of the most common media used in the laboratory. In contrast to the nutrient media, we have a complex media where the organisms, they refuse to grow by using peptone, by using certain meat extract or routinely used ingredients. Why? Because the requirement is fastidious. Fastidious means they need certain extra components, extra nutrients. For example, certain organisms, they grow luxuriantly when they are provided with a blood. That is, the medium is known as a blood agar. Certain organisms, they require the components from eggs. So such media where they use certain unusual compounds for the growth, like blood, eggs, serum, then these media are categorized as a complex media. These media have nutrients whose exact components are difficult to estimate, they are difficult to define. Then another way is synthetic or defined medium. In contrast to that, we have another one, that is a natural media. So that is called synthetic or natural. Now the synthetic media is the one in which each and every component of the medium is exactly known. Not only the amount, but also the composition. For example, we have Zepex Doxthorm agar medium, Davis and Migioli medium. In this medium, because they are synthetic, they have a components which are known. Because as we will study in a natural media, whose components are from a natural origin and they are cannot be defined exactly. In contrast to synthetic media, natural medium have the components, say for example, meat extract, peptone, or potato, or carrot. Then the medium which is made from this will differ from batch to batch, will differ from a bottle to bottle, or for a company to company. Because the meat extract prepared in one batch, it may contain a meat extract from one animal. The same batch may not be having the same animal, it will be from another animal. Similarly, a potato. Potato grown in one particular farm will be different, it will have a bit different composition from the potatoes grown in the next farm. And therefore, the exact chemical composition of the natural media is not known. So this is the basic difference between the synthetic media and the natural media. Now, a very important classification is the classification of the media based on its functional use and applications. We are using this media for various different ways, in different modes. For example, basal media, enriched media, selective media, enrichment media, then we have a differential media, and even a transport or holding media. There are many more, but these are the major heads under which we will classify on the basis of its functional use or on the basis of its applications. Now the first one, basal media. Again, basal media are very simple media which supports non-fastidious growth of bacteria, routinely cultivatable bacteria which you use it for your purposes, like enterobacteriaceae or bacilli group of organisms, or routine staphylococcus, they can all grow on such media. They are known as basal media. Be careful that basal media forms the basic components of the medium. If we want to make it selective, or if we want to make it differential, or if we want to enrich them, then we can do it by either adding some substances into it or by supplementing the basal medium additionally by certain external components. So that will make it either selective for some organisms, that will make it enriched medium for certain organisms. This way, the basal media are the one which will provide the routine components, and almost all organisms will possess these ingredients. So those are the types of what we call it as a basal media. The next one is enriched media. Now the name itself indicates, enriched media means preparing a medium, that is the basal medium is added with certain extra nutrients. That can be in the form of, let us say, blood, serum or eggs. Now because of this addition of certain extra nutrients, the medium becomes enriched, and that is why it will permit the growth of certain exciting bacteria. Exciting bacteria means fastidious bacteria, whose special requirements are met by using such kind of components. So certain organisms who have these kinds of requirements, certain fixed requirements which are provided by these elements or these compound, these materials, they can be grown on enriched media. Examples are, say, blood agar or a chocolate agar, Loeffler serum agar or Dorset's egg medium. Let me make you clear here is one point. The chocolate agar and blood agar, basically they are prepared both in the same way. Chocolate agar does not contain the component of chocolates. Okay, it is not containing any trophies or any sweets into it. However, the color is like a chocolate, because the blood, when it is added into the medium while it is still hot, certain components of the blood will chair, and instead of becoming red, it will become brownish in color. This is indicated in this figure. You can see on the left hand side chocolate agar, while on the right hand side we have a blood agar. Blood agar is blood red in color, while the chocolate agar is brownish in color. Then after an enriched media, we have a selective media. Naturally, this basal media containing a substance which inhibits the growth of the unwanted organisms, that is selective. The name itself indicates that we are selecting a particular group of organisms. So in order to prepare this medium, we should know the characteristics of the medium, in a sense that how these organisms are inhibited, what are the components that will not permit the growth of a particular group of organisms. And therefore, when we selectively prepare such kind of medium, that medium will permit the growth of one particular group of organisms. For example, mannitol salt agar used for cultivation Staphylococcus aureus, McConkie's agar used for Enterobacteriaceae, DCA used for Salmonella and Shigella, deoxycholate citrate agar, and thiosulfate bile sucrose agar used for cultivation of Vibrio. Again, the diagrams of McConkie's agar and deoxycholate citrate agar. Then we have enrichment. Now, this medium, enrichment media, they are usually the fluid media which favors the growth of the desired organisms. Be careful, this is different from enriched media. Enriched media means the media in which we are using a components which allow the growth of the fastidious organisms, nutritionally exciting organisms. While here, it is basically similar to that of a selective media. But the difference is, in selective media, the growth of one is inhibited. Here, in this case, the growth of one is favored. For example, salt meat broth only permits the growth of Staphylococcus aureus. Tetrathionate broth, it contains tetrathionate salts, will allow the growth of only Salmonella group of organisms. Selenite broth, again Salmonella and Shigella are used for that is the selenite is used for these two organisms, and alkaline potato water, it is used for the cultivation of vibrio. See this media, two media are there. As I told you, enriched media, they are basically a fluid media. Enrichment media, they are basically fluid media, that is the broth. And we can see here in the figure, one red in color, that is the selenite F broth, and the another one is tetrathionate bile green broth, which is green in color. Both are having a liquid consistency, that is broth in nature. Now comes a very important media, differential or indicator media. Now when we add certain ingredients, certain components, either it may be an indicator dye or it can be certain chemicals, which as a result of the metabolic activity of the cell will show certain visible changes, as a result of which we can differentiate between two different kinds of organisms. So differential media or indicator media, they contain some chemical substances or ingredients which are changed as a result of metabolic activity of microorganisms. Say for example, Mekong case agar, SS agar, WB agar, DCA, blood agar and XLD agar. In the figure, in the next slide, we have different plates. One on the left corner, top corner, is the Mekong case agar, which shows two different types of colonies. One is fermenter and non-fermenter, and the growth is on Mekong case agar. On the top right is again a Mekong case agar having a fermenter colonies. See the pink color colonies. While at the bottom we have on the bottom right left hand corner, we have a Wilson Blair's, that is the green color plate, while on the right hand side we have DC agar, xylose lysine deoxycholate citrate agar. It shows the colonies in a black color because the presence of H2S has led to the formation of a black growth. Production of H2S by Salmonella has led to the formation of the black colored colonies. So these are the various different types of differential media, or we can call it as an indicator media. Now the further discussions about transport media will be done by Kiran ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Actually, so far you have seen the discussion about all different kinds of media. You must have learned so many things from this discussion. Now one more type of media, that is a transport media. Why do we call this as a transport media? Actually, this media is normally used whenever some clinical specimens, they are to be transported from one place to another, or you can say from the place of collection to the laboratory, and they should be transported very fast. This is very necessary whenever we want to prevent the growth of contaminating microorganism, or we want to prevent the common cells. So to prevent the common cells, or to prevent the contaminating microorganism, or to prevent the drying of the specimen, this transport media are used. Some of the examples of transport media are Stewart's and Amis medium, Sachs buffered glycerol saline, Carey Blair medium. These are the some media which are used as a transport media. Here are the examples. You can see the different kinds of transport media. Now after this, one more point is which is going to be very important and equally important. So far whatever the media which have been used, we have not mentioned about the media which can be used for the growth of anaerobic organism. You understand that anaerobic organism are those microorganisms who do not require oxygen for their growth, or they require very less quantity of this oxygen. So for this kind of anaerobic bacteria, the media would be naturally different. So what type of media can be used for the cultivation of anaerobic organism? So normally we are making the use of some of the media in laboratory also, like Robertson's cooked meat medium and thioglycolate broth. Why do we use this kind of medium? Because anaerobic bacteria, as I have told you, that they do not require the oxygen. So the medium should have very low oxygen content, or the condition inside the medium should have low oxidation reduction potential. And this low oxidation reduction potential can be created by addition of glucose, thioglycolate, ascorbic acid, cysteine, or sometimes you can even red hot iron fillings can also make the medium less in amount of oxygen. So these are the different kinds of media which are basically used for the cultivation of anaerobic group of organism. Apart from this, I would like to add some few lines that we are also studying about the fungi and for the cultivation. Okay, before I say anything about that, this is the picture where you can see Robertson's cooked meat medium in the test tube, and you can see a layer of oil. This oil layer is created so as to reduce the amount of oxygen that may enter into the medium. Second is the thioglycolate broth. Both of these are very commonly used medium for the cultivation of anaerobic bacteria. Okay. In case of thioglycolate broth, one more thing I would like to add, that we are making the use of rhizazurine dye. Why do we add this dye? This dye is actually added whenever the organism have grown, they have used up everything in the medium and it is indicating a reduced condition. So whenever the anaerobic organism has grown in the thioglycolate broth, the rhizazurine will lose its color. So initially that pink color will become colorless. That is an indication that anaerobic organism has grown. Sir, I would like to add some more points about one more.
Yeah, you can talk about fungi too.
Yeah, actually time is very less, but still I would like to mention about that, because you people are going to use those medium in your practical work also. So for the cultivation of fungi, as in the early discussion I told you, that looking at the type of microorganism, we have to select the type of culture medium. So far you have seen the different types of medium for aerobic bacteria, for anaerobic bacteria, for this selective type of bacteria. Similarly for fungi, we are making the use of some different type of culture media, and these are the rose Bengal agar medium, potato dextrose agar medium, and Sebarot's agar medium, and these are the normally used medium for the cultivation of fungi, because the nutritional requirement of fungi or the environmental condition needed for fungi are different than the growth of bacteria. Hence this kind of media are used.
I would like to add to this that the conditions for fungi, for growing the fungi, are slightly different from those which are required from bacteria. And therefore, these media are either designed in such a way, either by adding certain chemicals or by changing the environment in which these media are incubated, so that it favors the growth of fungi. For example, one thing you should always remember, golden line, that most of the bacteria, they require alkaline pH to grow, while the fungi requires acidic pH. So though these media, they have basically the same ingredients, like source of carbon, source of nitrogen, and other growth factors. So they will have the basic ingredients same, but the pH is adjusted to slightly acidic conditions. That is around 5.6 or between 6 to 5.5. Second important thing is certain chemicals are incorporated into the medium. For example, in rose Bengal agar medium, we have added into that rose Bengal dye. This dye selectively inhibits the growth of bacteria. At the same time, this medium also contains antibiotic which are specifically inhibitory for bacteria. That is, bacteria being prokaryotes, they have 70S ribosomes, and eukaryotes have 80S ribosomes. So we take this advantage, this selective advantage, and we add streptomycin. That is, this particular antibiotic is acting on 70S ribosomes, and therefore bacteria will be inhibited while fungi are not touched up. They can is luxuriantly grow. Third thing is that apart from this, environmental conditions can be made unfavorable for the growth of bacteria, like incubating them at a lower temperature, Bacteria can grow luxuriantly at a temperature of 35-37 degrees centigrade, while fungi, most of the fungi isolated from soil, they can grow at temperature which is around room temperature, and therefore reducing the temperature of the growth. As a result, this growth of the bacteria is reduced or it is inhibited. So these are the ways by which we can grow fungi. One thing you should always remember, again, the golden rule is, if we want to know the, if we want to grow the organism, then what we should know is the growth requirement of that particular group or of that particular organism. So with this, ma'am, I would like to thank the students who have eagerly and very carefully taken pains to
attend
the discussion. If they have any questions, they are most welcome. They can ask me at any time. I also take this opportunity to thank Commissioner Madam, the coordinator of BISEC, that is the SANDHAN program, Surveyor Sir. I also extend my heartfelt gratitude and thanks to the BISEC staff of the studio, who has taken pains to bring this program live to you. So, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good day. Namaskar.
SANDHAN, All Gujarat Integrated Classroom.
Satellite na madhyam thi jodti kadi, etle SANDHAN.